Hey everyone, I'm Scott Cunningham, aka Scottsy Business, and today we're here again with Jeff Kirdeikis from Uptrennd. He's CEO and founder, and let's just dive in. First, I just wanted to talk about what's changed in Uptrennd over the past 6 months, aside from you guys growing at a ridiculous, awesome rate.
And I mean, that's been my favorite part of it, is the growth in the community and the engagement, and just how you start seeing more and more and more of the same people, and that's just like really proliferating. One of the big things that I think happened really recently that I was super excited about, like it's all in the community base, but there's a big meetup that happened in Nigeria, in Lagos, that just got put on by the community. There were like 93 people showed up. It was like this massive event. It was the coolest thing to me, like to just feel and see how this like just vision that's totally grassroots, that just can like those little pockets that pop up. There's a book, Sapiens,
just like, and they completely talk about community run too.
Yeah, exactly. And so there's this book called Sapiens, and they talk about how ideas are like a virus. And I think of that in like a positive context, so they can just like spread. And I'm like, that's so cool that it's like, you know, this like proliferation of this like positive virus has just like kind of blossomed in Nigeria. So that was probably one of the coolest things of the recent time that I can think of. Yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome. Mm-hmm. All right. Yeah. And in terms of like the actual like infrastructure and the site, like what are some of the major things that you guys have kind of progressed with, and like some major hurdles that you kind of covered and different things that you've come out with in the last like 6 months or kind of like a little quick overview of 2019, so to speak? I mean, there's a lot. So from whatever you can just kind of maybe more recently or what have you.
Yeah. A lot of the things are the things that happen behind the curtain, you know, that you wouldn't expect, like just like caching layers, making the site a little bit faster, little idiosyncrasies about how the mechanics in the back end work, and just getting really tight on that. A lot of it actually had to do with, I guess you could say, like the moderator panel, and just being able to like navigate that effectively and efficiently. Because, you know, you can just like put out the front end and that's really easy. But then, you know, people start abusing the system. I think that's the biggest thing, is we've just found ways that like, you know, people try to abuse it, and they're like, okay, here's how to counteract that. You know, because you have so many people creating duplicate accounts on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and they're not even earning anything. So it's like, okay, well, now if you make a website that pays people to earn, how they're really going to be inundating you. So we've been just trying to get really foundational on, okay, how do we set strong foundations so that we can scale this concept so that it's really fair for everybody? Because, you know, if someone's just earning a ton of points for creating duplicate accounts and referral links, then no, it's not really fair to everybody else.
Yeah, no, I think that's really important. That was kind of one of the major downfalls of Waku, which was like an alternative to Steam, because unlike Steam, where they lend out the Steam, Waku would just give anyone who signed up 100 Waku. So then everyone just started like making duplicates, putting it all into one account, selling it to new people who wanted to buy Waku at a lower price than what Waku was selling at, and it just kind of like destroyed the system. And now like all the Waku that I accrued over the entire time that I was there is worth like maybe like a dollar or less, but it was like 15,000, and I spent a ton of money acquiring it too. So it was just, it was an awful situation. And that's definitely something that's like really important to tackle early on.
Yeah, and hats off to you for trying all these different platforms and biting the bullet. I know there was one you said it cost like $100 to verify on or something like that. Like, that's nuts.
Yeah, saw me. But I mean, I think if they can like fix that or something, like it looks like it could be promising, but I don't know. I mean, essentially what they're saying is, like, I'm actually going to do an interview with him next week, so maybe I'll get some clarity. But like they talked about how, yes, well, eventually we'll allow you to buy it with our crypto, so like that'll solve the issue. But I'm still like, but you still have to like earn a ridiculous amount, and then to be able to even withdraw your funds. My main issue originally was just that if I put money in, I can't even get it back. So like, that's really concerning to me. And it's kind of the same with DLive, a little different, but very similar. Like with DLive, even if you put money in, you can't take out money now. This is just a new restriction, unless you've streamed for a certain amount. So as a user, you couldn't get your money back ever unless you were a creator. So because they made their rules synonymous with like earning DLive points versus like actually funding it and controlling your own funds. But Tron is acquiring it. I don't think they're going to change anything, because they're probably acquiring it because they like what's going on versus like radically trying to change it. But we'll see.
Right.
So we'll know more in like 5 days. So,
geez, Justin Sun building his little empire with Steam it as well within the last month.
Really? Yeah, I don't like. I heard that like there was like rumors that he might try to acquire that. So who knows?
I thought that was locked in. I thought that was locked in already.
Really? Oh man, I must be out of the loop. I'll have to look into that. Jeez.
Yeah. So if it's true, which I think it is, it's Steam it and DLive within a month. So he's really going hard. And I think it speaks to EOS and Voice coming out soon. How there's a big movement right now happening in that decentralized ecosystem, especially social media and media, especially with what happened with the YouTube content creators. So I think everyone's just, the focus is there right now, and people are really talking about it. Even you've seen like tweets from CZ, from Vitalik, from Jared Tate of Digibyte. They're all like, we need something. And I just find it so funny. It's like, there's so many things already there, whether it's Uptrennd or one of the other 50 platforms, who cares? But it's just like, we just need to start supporting these platforms and just stop being like, we need something. And there's always this chicken and the egg problem, I think, is what gets highlighted. He's like, we just need distribution. Like, we don't want to leave YouTube, the centralized platform, and go to these other ones because there's not as much eyeballs there. It's like, well, man, if you just took 1 second, and you're fantastic at this, to cross-post across all the different platforms, well, you've just totally helped the ecosystem grow, and it's literally no sweat off your back. It takes an extra 3 seconds. So I find it just very interesting, this dichotomy of these, big influencers who hold a lot of weight in being able to like make this shift happen, but then they don't take an extra 30 seconds to like really support that thing that they're kind of crying out for.
Yeah. Like, I don't know if it's virtue signaling or if they just haven't really taken the time, but it sucks when it's like, it's so easy and they'd probably do really well on these platforms. So it's like, there's only benefit for them to check these platforms out.
Yeah, exactly. And that's it. And like, the earlier you get in on these platforms, the more established you become. Like, Steam it, everyone who got in early there, super established. You're super established on Mines because you were early there, Uptrennd as well. And so it's like, there's just so many benefits to just spending that little bit of time. But I understand people, they're like, no, this is my bread and butter. Like, I don't want to spread the butter too thin. So
and then YouTube comes and takes all the butter, right?
So that's right. Yeah. Then you're on a 40-day vision quest fasting.
yeah, exactly. All right. So what are some of the big things that we should be on the lookout for 2020 for Uptrennd?
Okay. So I'll say two that a lot of people already know about, and then one that nobody knows about yet, except for the internal team. So first two that I'm really excited about are investing in content is one. So let's say, you make a post, you're new on the platform and I see it. I'm like, that is a badass post. I'm going to boost your post using my points. I'm going to submit a proposal to you and be like, yo, how about we split it 50-50? Or maybe I get 90% and you get 10%. Then I can shoot a proposal to you and you can say yes, no, or counter propose and kind of like find this equilibrium, because there's value from all the way from 0 to 100%. So I think that's going to be really cool to help empower new users to really get a lot more exposure. If someone makes a good post but they don't have followers, that's the big problem on Steam it. How do you get that exposure? Well, somebody sees the post, like, this is quality. It should be seen. I'll boost it and then, split the profits or whatever. I think that's going to go really well.
That sounds kind of like an upgrade to what Mines has. Mines has an offer program, but you can only just make one original offer, and there's no like counter proposal, and like you can't earn off of theirs. It's really just like, let me pay you a certain amount and you can like repost my post. That's kind of how it is. It's very basic, but it didn't really get adopted much because, you couldn't give an example of what you wanted different or counter proposal or anything like that. Right. It was just accept or decline and like, that's it. So yeah, it sounds like you kind of like, you probably didn't even know about that, but it sounds like in theory, you took that and you like brought it to the next like level, so to speak.
Right. Yeah. That's the first I've heard of it. Surprisingly, I thought I was staying up to date with Mines. They're building at a breakneck speed too.
No, I mean, just no one uses it. That's why. I mean, Offers has been around from the very beginning, but just one uses it. One uses it. Right. Like I tried doing it a lot originally, but just it didn't really take. Like no one uses Offers. Everyone uses the boost, but no one uses the Offers side of things.
Because, so for example, just so I get clarity, because I don't fully understand. So if I want to send an offer to you, what's in it for me? If I want to boost your content?
Yeah, it's not necessarily boosting someone else's content. It's like,
oh, okay,
you would pay me 5 Minds tokens to repost your post on my wall.
I see.
Yeah, it's a little different. But it's also, right, one thing that's concerning about it is it's also permanent. And you could like change the post afterwards.
Oh, that's
like,
terrible.
Yeah, like because you can still edit your post, but it would permanently still be reposted on their side because you paid them, right? So they're trying to make it so like you can't screw someone over after they paid you, but then they could edit it and switch it to just like terrible, awful things. So
I could think of 1,001 hilarious ways that could be exploited.
Yeah, literally the very first video, like after, like I had some videos back in the day on YouTube, but my current like episode number one is be careful of Minds boost for offers. Right. So like that's literally the first video that I had of them on there. So yeah,
that's good. Yeah. So the second thing that I'm excited about that we're going to be rolling out with is owning a community. This is really cool. The Narrative was the one that kind of put us this like rest in peace Narrative. I think they totally scammed everyone and fuck them for that. But it was a cool concept. And so the concept is you can buy a community and then earn passive income off every upvote that occurs in that community. And I just think that is such a phenomenal idea and brings ownership back to the people. So like just how finding more ways that people can monetize and gamify the platform. So I'm really excited for that one.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. I think I saw you guys talking about that. And I think that's really cool too. I think you guys will probably do a much better job of it than Narrative, because I mean, they were just kind of sketchy in the beginning for like many different reasons. Like you probably saw my thing or maybe read into it yourself, but you know, like they raised so much money and they only ever gave out like $1,500 and then somehow went bankrupt. And they also sold like over 1,000 niches and they had people paying $15 to certify. So it's like, with all this money coming in, like what were they doing with it? You know,
and it's just, it blows my mind. They had an investment round open on like a crowdfunding site and they'd already like secured $3 million or something. And that was literally weeks before they closed up shop. It's absurd. Yeah. Crazy.
That's crazy. Yeah.
Oh, well, that's just the nature of the game, I guess. Hey, it's unfortunate that there's always bad actors in the space, but it is what it is. And then, so yeah, the last one, this is the exclusive sneak peek for anyone who's listening in on this, is we are going to be expanding into new communities now outside of cryptocurrency.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah. I'm sure a lot of people have been waiting for that.
Yeah. So that'll be good. We're going to do a community poll. We've kind of like shortlisted 10 different topics that we feel would be relevant next moves. And we'll put a poll to the Uptrennd community, see what the top three are, and then we're going to roll out with just three to just, you know, get our sea legs and okay, what does this feel like? How does the system interact once there's more in there? And then from there, we'll expand out to all communities. So the time is ripe. It's been a year. We've got 50,000 users now, and we just feel it's time to expand. So we're really excited about it. I'm really excited about it too. It's going to be a good time.
Yeah, no, that's really awesome because I've been like I occasionally do stuff on like censorship and different things like that. Yeah. And I haven't been sharing it on Uptrennd, but I'm sure that community would really like to see the different things going on in that space. So yeah, I'm really, really excited to see that. I think that's going to be awesome. And maybe I'll put that in the title even or something of this, because like, yeah, that's really cool.
Yeah.
So that's going to be really, really awesome. I'm really excited about that.
Mm-hmm.
So is there anything else you want to talk about on Uptrennd? Like I think I saw that you guys said you might introduce staking as well. Is that something that might be in the works, or is that just being talked about, or what's the situation with that?
Definitely. Yeah. So we will be introducing staking very likely within the next month. It's looking like we're going to be partnering up with Ferrum. So we'll have different staking amounts. Obviously, the longer you lock in your tokens, the higher percent interest you can earn. But we're also looking at a different model where it's a proportional staking. So if, for example, cause like you could have fixed rate, if you stake this much for this long, you earn this percent. But another model that we've been looking at that's actually really interesting is if there's only this many, like a small amount of tokens, you earn a ridiculously high amount of interest. But then as the token amount gets smaller, you earn less and less interest. So it's kind of like a free market staking economy, which I find quite interesting. So we're still playing with the pros and cons between both, but everything is set up to launch out with staking. Yeah.
No, that's really, really cool. Yeah. I think, it'll be really familiar for users coming from like Steam and other places where they know about staking. So yeah, no, I think that's going to be really, really interesting. And it's cool that you guys kind of have the like locked in like level system, and then you also have staking, so there's like multiple ways for people to use their points. And it really seems like you guys have the best, or like the best utility with your points, like in terms of boosting and being able to like level up and earn more, or soon to be able to stake. So like there's a lot of like utility and different things that they can actually use the points for, so I think that's really key.
Definitely. Yeah, no, that's something we like really enjoy doing. Is you should see our back end, like internal documents of like ideas and creativity, like the amount of, if we could just like snap our fingers, there'd be like 1,001 different things you could use the one up for. We have so many amazing ideas in the pipeline. But yeah, that's, we really enjoy like that gamified aspect, like bringing utility, a full girthy ecosystem. And then just off the top of my mind, one thing I do want to mention that I am also looking forward to coming soon is something we're going to call blips, which is similar to like a Twitter tweet. So if it's less than 280 characters, then you don't have to click to see the post. It'll just be scrollable on your screen.
Okay.
So I'm looking forward to that, because I feel the one experience that I'm missing with Uptrennd personally is like, it's, for me, I find it a little bit arduous to like click back, click. It's too much clicking. Like when I love just like scrolling through Twitter. So we want to introduce that same feeling onto Uptrennd as well. So it'll be like a mix between, you know, those article styles and videos, but also the blips as well, where people can just like scroll, enjoy, digest content easily that way.
Yeah, so it'll feel a little bit more kind of like Minds, where you've got like the long format and then you've got like the quick little text post. Yeah, no, I think that'll be really good, so that you can actually have that kind of those like quick little updates and like little back and forth things. Cause I never used Uptrennd to just, you know, make a quick little post, like, you know, like I'm going for the holiday and I'll be back in 7 days, just so you guys know, right, or something. Any kind of like updates or anything that might be relevant for followers, I think that'll be really, really useful. So you also wanted to talk about decentralized systems and then how they relate to data storage, freedom of speech, and data immutability. Do you want to just kind of get started with that?
Sure. Yeah. I always think, I'm like, man, imagine if someone just didn't know what any of those words were. That would just be like a total jumble.
But yeah, I guess I think break that down first.
Totally. I think, yeah. So in YouTube, you know, recently, anyone who's not familiar, I think it was pretty big news, especially on the old crypto Twitter, that YouTube took down a ton of influencer or just even creators' content. If you created crypto content, they took it down. And so it really showed the issue with censorship on these centralized platforms. That was kind of like the big ethos everyone was saying. It's like, we got to get off centralized platforms. We got to move to decentralized platforms who aren't going to censor us. Mm-hmm. And so I just find it's like this like strange half truth, I find, though, because if you look at something like, let's take library, which is, you know, the most common one that everyone was talking about at that time. And everyone's like, okay, let's switch to library. Let's post all of our content there. Well, first of all, on a legal standpoint, YouTube and library can only post the same thing. So library can't post, you can't post, you know, like, you know, pornography or like really, I won't say the list, like really obscene illegal things on library, and you can't post it on YouTube. It's because there's a company behind both of them. So we have, library has to take that content down. Where am I going with this? Sorry, let me backtrack my thought. And on shit, I totally lost my train of thought here. That's hilarious.
Well, I mean, before we get back into it, do you want to just kind of break down data storage, freedom of speech, and then data immutability, just in case there is some people who weren't totally aware of those terms?
Right. Okay. Yeah. So data storage is like how it's being stored. So is it just stored on an Amazon web server? Like most all websites are stored and held on AWS, Amazon web server. And so everyone's like, well, why don't you kind of put it like a torrent? So, you know, put it on like essentially like when you're torrenting a movie, and then you can upload it from multiple people at multiple times, multiple people own it. So you're not relying on Amazon to host your data. So it makes it a lot, I guess you could say, safer or more decentralized. There's not a single point of failure. And then the other topic was censorship. And I think that's the big one that I was kind of pointing at here with between YouTube and library or Uptrennd or any decentralized platform, to kind of re-catch my train of thought, is that, you know, YouTube never started out as someone who's like, you know, we're going to censor crypto content. It's like, it just naturally happened. They just kind of like gravitated that way. It's like what's the phrase? Like, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. And it's just this sometimes slippery slope. And when you get pressure that's put on you from whether it's governing agencies or regulators or whatever it may be, you start making these questionable decisions on, okay, what are we going to censor? What aren't we going to censor? Are we going to take down crypto because, you know, it's maybe a security and now we're seen as promoting securities? And YouTube just makes a call based on that. You know, why they took it down, who knows? But I think kind of the ethos of it is, well, library and YouTube are inherently the same structure. I mean, the underlying tech, you know, where it's stored is in a way irrelevant because what's being hosted by a company, it's like someone's head is on the chopping block. For example, everyone's like, oh, I wish we could just have this big freedom of speech platform where you could post anything and everything and there was no censorship. And it's like, well, unfortunately, there's only one way that that's possible. And that's if somebody anonymously launches it and then it's nobody builds on it from that point forward. Because if there's anything illegal on there, somebody's head's going to be on the chopping block. And that's, you know, what happened with Silk Road. Illegal content, someone's head's on the chopping block. And so it's just like you need to comply with laws and regulations, even if you're a decentralized platform. And so I think that's kind of like the big ethos that I think is kind of the big misconception or just overgeneralization that people are putting out there is that, okay, if you're decentralized, then it's total free reign. It's like, no, you're still going to be just as susceptible to government pressures unless you've structured it as a decentralized autonomous organization and you have totally stepped away from it completely. Because you can't just say, you know what, hey, we're going to do community governance, but like I still own it, like equity. Because if the community messes up, it's all on the person who owns the platform. So it's this big idea of like altruistic DAO. It's so beautiful. And I feel like, you know, we can slowly get there. But just the way that things are set up right now, I think, and I'd love to hear, you know, maybe in the comments, somebody rip me apart and tell me why I'm wrong, because that's fantastic, because then we can actually build these things. But it's still very much on par with in terms of the censorship side of things.
Yeah. I mean, similar to what you mentioned with the road to hell is paved with good intentions, Alan Watts is by far my favorite philosopher. And one of the things that he said was, it's perfectly obvious that everything is going to hell. The only thing that we could do is not try to stop it. And trying to stop it is what, like, that's the only thing that is really causing it, is trying to stop it, because it's the natural way of things is to decay over time. And trying to get in the way is what's actually speeding up the process. And it's like, and it's so hard for people to like let that go, but that's like a fundamental part of it. And I thought that was really like an interesting revelation when I heard him say that. But yeah, no, you're definitely right. Like, some people have unrealistic expectations. Like, when everyone jumped on Gab for wanting to like remove pornography from their platform, I thought that was like unwarranted. I mean, their reasoning wasn't the greatest, because they went on for a religious take. They should have just said like, we don't want pornography on the platform because that's not speech. But they kind of took a weird like angle at it. But I still think it's not like against free speech to say there's no porn on this platform, because, you know, I wouldn't even say porn is foundational to free speech. It's just like, certain libertarian types will argue like everything that's possible to be posted or shared is all free speech. So it's like, that's kind of like reaching a little far. And it's like, if we're going to have functioning platforms, we have to have some grounding to like, for it to be realistic.
Yeah. I think that's such a phenomenal point, is everything is so subjective on what is free speech. And so if I think the moment that one person says, hey, that's not free speech, you can't be like, oh yeah, like freedom of speech. Like, you can like try to empower that movement, which is like what Uptrennd is about. But like you say, you know, one person could be like, hey, you're not showing pornography. Like, that's not freedom of speech. And now like the counter argument, now it's just a subjective bias. And so that's where things get sticky. It's like, if you can't, and then someone might say, well, me selling drugs, that's freedom of speech.
Like, because then you go far the other way too. Exactly. Because people will say, it's like, well, when you make an exception, then there'll be an infinite amount of exceptions. And it's like, but you could say the same thing the other way. If we say, okay, fine, porn is allowed, then it's like, okay, fine, selling drugs is allowed, okay, fine. Like, it's like, it can go both ways. So there has to be a happy medium, and you can't like go crazy about, like, you know, really small things. And like, obviously, if they started to say like, okay, well, hate speech and this, it's like, then it's like, okay, yeah, like that's a little more like concerning when you start going down the rabbit hole. But, you know, when we're talking about strictly speech, I think, you know, pornography is definitely safe to cast aside from that. And people just need to have some grounding in reality for what's like realistic and what's going to be allowed on a platform that you could use at work or that like kids or like, you know, like younger people could use or whatever. It still has to be realistic and obviously law abiding.
For sure. And, you know, I think filters are so important. You know, on Reddit, they have the NSFW filter. So it's like, if you don't want to see that content, or you almost have to opt in to see that content, mm-hmm. which I think is really valuable. Because then you have that, you could say, freedom of speech, or, you know, that content can live on the platform. But, you know, it's not going to be subjected to kids. Maybe you have like an age opt in. Maybe it's protected. I mean, it would be terrible if it was protected by KYC. That's so frictiony. But, you know the ethos there. Like some kind of opt-in. So I think filters are really powerful. And then to kind of touch on the censorship part again, I think what I've just been brainstorming in my own head and chatting with the team about is, I think the best way to go about this, because when YouTube censored all these posts or like all this content, it just got taken down. And now all these content creators are just left sending emails to a spot that they have no idea if it's going to get received, reciprocated at all. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a major problem. I just had my Facebook deactivated for 50 days, actually. It got totally deleted. I sent over a dozen emails. Not a single email came back. I had to pay a guy who worked at Facebook to get my account back. So it's like the systems aren't set up for this kind of scale. And so a solution that I see that works really well that helps empower this, the people is community arbitration. So if your post gets removed, then you can kind of appeal that, and you need to get something like a super majority of 80% of the community on board to be like, yes, like that's fine, come back on. Otherwise, mm-hmm. then you can wait for the moderators. And I think, you know, something that happened or like with the YouTube content creators, they'd for sure get that super majority instantly. All their content mm-hmm. would be back. Their strikes would be removed. And I think that allows for a lot more fair and in a way streamlined process and scalable too, really.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm pretty sure like Minds kind of has a jury system that's similar to that, where you can appeal, and then you could even appeal and appeal, and they just get a bunch of people who aren't following either of the people involved. And it's a pretty good, like, I'm sure it could be improved, but because it's still like early process, but I think they're doing a really good job of trying to decentralize the moderation aspect. And yeah, like speaking to that, like Facebook suspends my account all the time for like just the simplest things. And then I finally get my account back and they're like, was this you? And it's like a picture of me and my family for Christmas. And it's like, of course that was me. It's like, did you comment and say thanks for the Christmas wishes? Was that you? It's like, of course. Like, it's like the simplest stuff. It's like, I post on Facebook like a few times a year. And it's like, even that's concerning. Like, it's ridiculous. And I was recently banned from Daily Motion as well. And I don't even know why. It was after I just uploaded an interview with Unstoppable Domains. So I have no idea there, and I emailed them and they never responded. So yeah, it's ridiculous when like you just get kicked off platform, you have no idea why, no communication, and then it's like, and that's it. It's like, unless you're a really, really big creator, like you're not going to get a response, and even then you might not get a response. So it's crazy.
Because, you know, it feel like, you know, they're kind of like really tightening the grip. I've heard of tons of people getting, you know, their accounts, you know, banned, deactivated, deleted, whatever combination of those. And it's like, okay, so why are they doing this? It's because they're trying to, I guess you could say, streamline or increase the quality of the platform, you know, make sure that there's no scammers, spammers, all this kind of thing. But I just think, you know, what is their success rate on that? I would imagine, you know, like at least 20% of the time, it's someone who they probably shouldn't be banning. And I just feel it's like that, what they're doing is so counterproductive if they're trying to increase the quality of their platform, because now all people are migrating away from Facebook. I think the stat was like in 2018, 44% of people deleted the Facebook app from their phone. It was like males ages 18 to 34, 40 some percent. It was nuts. So mm-hmm. it's so mind boggling to see how they're just, you know, treating. Well, maybe not mind-boggling, so obviously they know what they're doing in a way, but it's interesting to see how they really feel like tightening the noose is you know, beneficial for their profitability, and their profitability ties directly into how many people are using the platform. It's such a, it's really ironic, I feel.
Yeah, I mean, it's good that Libra did not launch this year. So, yeah, and hopefully it does not ever launch. And speaking of YouTube, like, I honestly expected them to be, like, after all the crypto craze, to be like, yeah, so we're launching a YouTube coin and, like, you know, and then come out with, like, their own crypto. And it's like, we just want to get everyone off talking about all the other coins first and just have people talking about YouTube coin. I wouldn't have been surprised if that was the case. And for all I know, that may still be the case. But yeah. I mean, Facebook, it's good that they didn't launch Libra, and too many really centralized people starting to dip their toes into crypto now, and it's just concerning if they might be able to, like, get a real hold, like Tron getting DLive. I really hope that they make it better rather than just, like, capitalize on what they're already doing.
Yeah, I always find the Libra conversation so interesting. You know, a lot of people strongly against it, and a lot of people are, myself included, in a way, you might hate me for saying this, but, like, kind of for it, because you know, for example, over half the world's population are unbanked or underbanked, but a lot of them have Facebook on their phone. So if they can interact for free and quickly, and for, you know what I mean, like, fast, cheap payments that they don't have to spend 10% Western Union, whether you're, like, Filipino working in North America or some refugee in Europe trying to send money back to their family, I feel like it's a really good benefit to give people that benefit. And then for us, you know, who live in first world, it's like, you know, that's not for us, it's centralized, so we can opt into other systems that are more decentralized, fit with our ethos, like Bitcoin or Ethereum or whatever we want to buy into. So I find that an interesting conversation, because, you know, even though a lot of these platforms are centralized, like, you know, a lot of people hate on EOS because there's only 21 BPs, and it's like, well, yeah, but, like, they do a lot of transactions per second, so what's your preference? And I feel that's such a subjective thing. It's like, if you prefer fast, go to EOS. If you prefer decentralized, go to Ethereum. And that's an overgeneralization, but I think that's the beauty of crypto, I find, is that it gives people options to kind of be like, hey, I like this, I'm going to opt in here. I understand how this could give value to somebody else.
Yeah, no, that's fair. Mind you, though, EOS has had struggles with their CPU usage for way too long. I have not been able to make a transaction in 3 months. And apparently they made an upgrade like 4 days ago, but today I wanted to test that, and my $20 stake is still only half of what is required to make a single transaction. So I just don't think it's realistic for someone to be like, yeah, I'm going to join the platform, I have to put in like $50 and I can make two transactions a day. It's like, I don't see that happening. And I can't even unstake and sell my EOS because I wouldn't be able to make the transaction. So, like, now I just have $20 just, like, gone until that ever gets fixed. So that's pretty concerning to me. And I don't know how Voice is going to fare with that when that gets launched in February, but we'll see. But yeah, I mean, my take on Libra is I do think that would be good for, like, the unbanked, but I also feel like that was probably their, like, altruistic argument to try to, like, make the, because I mean, realistically, what it also means is we want to be able to advertise to 30% of the world that isn't getting our ads. And it's like, right, and they say it was decentralized because it's split between 100 companies, but it's the 100, like, most powerful companies in the world. So how decentralized is that really? It's like, and obviously they're gonna act in the best interest of Facebook so that they can make money. I do think it would have been interesting, but also very concerning, because then eventually, since everyone is using it, they could be like, okay, well, now, you know, you can't use this and you can't use this and you can't use this. And it's like, okay, like, it's like, what if everyone only accepts Libra coin eventually, and then you can't use eBay anymore because, like, you're kicked off of Facebook or whatever it might be. Like, it could get really, really bad in terms of centralization. But I do think it would be good for people who need that access, but I feel like there could be a better solution given to those people who don't have that access.
100%. That's exactly it. With these centralized entities, it's always so scary. And I think to China and their social credit score and their bank accounts, or, like, whether it's WePay or whatever, but if you jaywalk in China and you get caught on the facial recognition system, boom, they drain your bank account instantly without your permission. I'm like, wow. And so that's the scary part to me about or like the empowering thing maybe on the other side about, okay, currencies that aren't like that or aren't like Libra. It's like, okay, this is Bitcoin. I hold my keys. You guys can all fuck off. Like, there's no way you can touch this.
Exactly. You know? Exactly. Yeah. Because it's just so concerning. Like, what if like your kid starts to run across the road and then you chase after them and grab them and then it doesn't take in the context and it's like,
that's right. Yep,
you're not, all of your money is gone. It's like, I was just trying to like save my child or even someone else's kid. Like you just go to save someone else and then you get your bank account drained for doing something that was good. It's like, what kind of social credit doesn't even account for good acts? And I don't know exactly how that would work, but I'm sure that's probably, I doubt it'll take in the context of the situation. So everyone's just, you know, looking over their shoulder as they kind of do their stuff.
Yeah, I don't think China has a decentralized arbitration community-based system.
Yeah. It's probably all algorithmic. So,
Yeah.
So in terms of like data immutability, do you want to touch on that a little bit? I don't know if we covered that thoroughly.
Right. Yeah. No. You're right. We didn't touch on that really. So the data immutability. So like, first of all, like immutability just means like it can't be deleted. So you know, if you're hosted on YouTube, obviously the data was not immutable. They took it off because they're like, hey, this doesn't follow in line with our principles or guidelines. Down it goes. And I think it was like, we need a platform with data immutability. I'm like, yes, we do, 100%. But again, what does that look like? Because it ties in directly with censorship. Because you go to library and you upload a post, well, they can also take that down off their front end. And then how do you re-download that off the blockchain? Because I guarantee you they're not storing terabytes upon terabytes of files on a blockchain. That's not how it works. It's like a hash to a file. And then, but who's, okay, so you have this hash to re-download the file. But if the person holding, let's say that hash correlates to 100 different pieces of data held by 100 people, the only reason those 100 people are holding that data, or it should be, is because they're getting paid to seed the content to the platform. So first of all, that's a big problem with a lot of IPFS systems is that they're not paying people to seed. So most platforms like DLive, or I think DLive just have like a couple servers. They're almost just as centralized as Amazon Web Services. So that's an issue in itself and a big misconception. But the thing is once library or any decentralized platform removes it off the front end, there is now no longer an incentive for people to continue to host that data. So they drop it off their hard drive because that like space is valuable and limited. So why would they host it? So I think the thing is like the moment library takes something off their front end, just like YouTube could, well, now your decentralized server or like the underlying torrent is likely going to disappear really fast too. So, you know, maybe you have a window of like 14 days before the guys who are storing it realize they're not making any money off it. But I think, yeah, like full immutability, like people are like, oh, it's on the blockchain. It's always going to be there. It's like, no, man, the hash is there, but you're not going to be able to pick up the file itself.
Hmm. Yeah, no, that's really important to consider. Yeah. I think it's like the hash is there or like the text is there, but it's like, is the files going to be there? Not as likely. So yeah, definitely something that people need to be aware of when, you know, cause a lot of platforms are throwing around like blockchain and decentralized as like these great terms. And it's kind of more like a hype thing. Like with DLive, for example, I would say people going in there thinking it's like a blockchain live streaming platform are very misled in terms of what it actually is. But I mean, again, it might all change in 5 days. We'll see.
Yeah. And I mean, like, I'll be the first to admit that Uptrennd is a big culprit in a lot of these things too, where it's like, hey, data immutability and freedom of speech type thing. It's like, well, these are the directions that we're trying to head more and more and more over time. And these are foundational pillars. And it's like, for as long as the project exists, this is the direction we're heading in. So like, if any decisions come in, like, hey, we should do this. It's like, okay, well, does that line up with the direction that we want to go? And it's like, it's our true north, I guess you could say. Mm-hmm. You know, for anyone who's listening, like, you know, we didn't get a bunch of funding. So we just like started really grassroots and we're just slowly building into that direction. So yeah, I think people just got to keep their eyes on these platforms and how they're you know, what actions they're taking. And I find, you know, the microcosmic actions are really indicative of the macro picture on what's to come and how they really value you. And, you know, getting all these crypto content creators getting deplatformed or Facebook banning and all these things, it's like, this is just indicative of, you know, what they stand for. So you got to look at other alternative platforms and be like, okay, well, you know, what has like Gab been doing? What's Mines been doing? What's Uptrennd been doing? PublishOX, like what's their ethos and their values? And is that scalable into the future? So there's certainly no silver bullet or golden bullet, whatever the phrase is. But I think, you know, you do it the best to just distribute your content across multiple platforms. And it doesn't take much more time. And at the end of the day or at the end of the year or at the end of the decade, you're going to be so much better off doing that, because you're going to be a first mover on these platforms that really have been able to come up with like you as a leader there.
Yeah, and I think that's really important. I feel like I kind of caught wind of all these things that were going to happen like years ago when I started getting into the decentralized and blockchain platforms. And, you know, I kept telling people, it's like, look, this is the way that things are progressing, that censorship is becoming more and more rampant. And it seems like it's just going to get worse and worse. And if you don't get ahead of the curve, you're just going to have to deal with when you get pushed off and then trying to play catch up. So, you know, I take all the precautions I could possibly do. Every video I upload, I save the description, I save the title, I save the video and a backup drive. Like any possible backup measures I could take, I do, because I can't just rely on, you know, some entity to take all care of all of that for me. People need to take a little more personal responsibility in backing up their stuff and being able to rely on themselves before they rely on any entity. Because again, at the end of the day, like you said, a lot of them are subject to Amazon servers, and you know, there's tons of backdoors and potential issues that could pop up. So the best thing that people can do is decentralize, be on as many platforms as possible. And I think that about covers most of what we were going to talk about today. And I guess really people should be getting on Uptrennd to get themselves set up, because you guys are doing a lot of great work.
Yeah, thanks. I definitely suggest it. Yeah, like distribution of your content across multiple platforms. I'm not saying Uptrennd's the silver bullet, but it's certainly something interesting that I think would be valuable for people.
One of the bullets in the chamber, at least.
That's right. There we go. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you so much for jumping on and doing this. I really appreciate it, especially that little nugget about being able to create new communities outside of crypto. I think that's going to be huge. And I'm sure people are going to be really excited to hear about that. So, I'm definitely going to be posting this very soon. So I really appreciate it again for you to come on and share. And hopefully we'll talk again soon with some awesome updates about Uptrennd maybe hitting 100,000.
Yeah, hopefully. Really appreciate you letting me come on and taking the time, Scott.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. Cheers.